stand-up comedian. I think it was Rosie O'Donnell in the 80s. Is it her? Maybe it was Paula Townsend. It was a woman. And she did this thing about how her grandfather's answering machine message was basically just like him cussing in this like thick Irish accent because he couldn't figure out how to make the thing work. And I honestly feel like that's kind of what's happening here. Looks like I still have zero viewers. So I guess I'm just talking. Somebody says the last one that was such a miserable failure changed his life. Oh, that's funny. Hi, welcome, one viewer. I don't know who you are. I'm doing this for a couple of reasons, just because I think it will be fun, and also because I forgot to make my phone quiet. So, that's my son texting me. Hey, look, this is, make sure there's nothing personal on this that I don't want you to see. Oh, there's that. I would rather you didn't see that. No, it's not a picture of my Wang, it's my address. It's my new phone. Yay, go me. Anyhow, I'm doing this for a couple of reasons. The first thing I'm going to do is my phone. This is just not going well. Oh, goodness. Hi, I'm doing this for two reasons. Just because I thought it would be fun and timely, and especially because, you know, all the Star Trek stuff, but also because I am doing a Google Plus Hangout with a bunch of brewers later this week. I'm doing a thing with the guys from Victory and Dogfish Head and my friend Greg from Stone, and everyone is concerned that my uploading bandwidth is not going to be good enough to do this from home. My ISP caps me at 1.5 megabits, and I think I need it to really be like 6 or at least 3. I don't know. So if this looks like shit, then I'll know that I have to call Phantom Freak, the king of 9X, and have him hack the main frame to frame the main business. I hope you can hear me. If someone, this, what's going to happen is because it says there's 159. Hi, everybody. I'm going to do my best to make this work through time, I promise. Can you hear me okay? Someone will say that, and there's a little bit of a delay. So I guess I'll be able to see in the thing. The video is loved. Okay, all right, thanks, Clive, Michael, and Alan. Great, Brad, appreciate it. Great, so here we go. This is Memories of the Future, Volume 1, as it appears on my iPad. And I just thought that it would be fun and silly to perform the chapter for Where No One Has Gone Before, because that is airing in movie theaters all over the place tonight in celebration of Star Trek and in celebration of the 25th anniversary Blu-ray coming out tomorrow, which honestly I think is really cool. So I'm just going to go ahead and do that. And I don't know, so maybe be like 15-ish minutes or something like that. And I hope you enjoy it. So here we go. This is called Where No One Has Gone Before. It originally aired October 26, 1987. It was written by Diane Duane and Michael Reeves. It was directed by Rob Bowman. The star date was 41263.1. Here's the synopsis. The Enterprise meets up with the USS Fearless, an Excelsior-class starship that has just had its warp engines totally spiffed out by an engineer named Kaczynski, who also drew some totally cool flames down the side of the warp nacelles when he was done putting baseball cards in the engine's spokes. Starfleet wants Kaczynski to hop onto the Enterprise and trick out the engines of the Federation's flagship so the Federation can win the big drag race against the Romulans down in the dry riverbed galaxy after school gets out. Picard is cool with this, but Riker isn't convinced that they need to stick a foxtail on the antenna. He tells Picard that Kaczynski sent some specs over, but they're total bullshit. Data backs him up with a surprisingly brief explanation. Remember, this is the first season where Data talks for pages at a time when you ask him a yes or no question. Picard gets really pissed that Riker is questioning his authority, but he lets Riker take Counselor Troy with him to the transporter room to check out Kaczynski when he arrives. When they get there, Troy and Riker join Chief Engineer Argyle in this 18-millimeter lens, it's the end of the day and we have to get this before the producers pull the plug, three-shot, as Kaczynski arrives, steps off the transporter pad and reveals to everyone that he is an epic douche. We also meet Kaczynski's assistant, who tells us that his name is unpronounceable by humans, an awesome Star Trek device that makes its first of many appearances in The Next Generation. Kaczynski pees on Riker's leg a little bit to mark his territory. He sniffs over at Argyle's butt, and then he goes to engineering to work his totally awesome brand of warp drive magic. When he leaves, Troy tells us that he's loud and arrogant. Riker must be so happy that he brought her along for that deep and non-obvious insight. But she then adds that she doesn't feel anything for the mysterious assistant, like he isn't even there. Argyle turns to Riker and says, "That's what she said!" Riker gives him a disapproving look as eerie music swells up, so the slower kids in the audience know that we should be worried. A few minutes later in engineering, Kaczynski whizzes on the engine, and Riker and Argyle follow as he gets ready to do his tune-up thing. Trekkies who may have begun to dislike Kaczynski immediately start a fan club when he stops midstream to ask, "Why is this child here?" in reference to Wesley Crusher. I have to say, that's a pretty good recreation of Stanley Campbell, who played Kaczynski's performance of that line, if I do say myself, because I haven't seen this episode since I wrote the book 3-plus years ago. So I'm ringing the bell for me on that. Ah, and I'm dropping the microphone on the ground. Sorry. Son of a bitch. You know what that is? The gods of hubris telling me that I should not be so free with the ringing of the bell, because they might just knock the microphone down and make me feel like a jackass. In any event, Kaczynski says, "Why is this child here?" in reference to Wesley Crusher, who was working on a school project and wearing a magnificent burnt sienna sweater straight out of Klingon designer Katak Ba'akotot's fall collection. No joke, William Werteis, the original costume designer, had me go to some dude's house to have my colors done. As a 14-year-old who was really into the sweet pastels and bright neon colors of the late 80s, I was mortified to discover that I was an autumn with a brief touch of winter sweetheart, who would get to wear oranges, browns, greens, and pukes until I finally got my official spacesuit, which, in the second season, when it was the gray spacesuit that spent half of its time up my ass, not a lot better. After a few more moments of Kaczynski being a condescending dick, Riker cock-blocks him and makes him explain exactly how his cute little spaceship speeding up thing works. While he explains, his assistant naturally ignores all the open engineering consoles, and he goes and takes the one right next to where Wesley Crusher was working. Jesus Christ, man, didn't Argyle just tell them that Wesley is busy with a school project? Come on, dude, I got work to do. Wesley watches the assistant lay in some commands, but something bothers him, so the assistant lets Wesley tinker with the coordinates himself. Yeah, that's not going to cause any problems or piss off the audience. After Wesley is done, the assistant gives him this look that, in retrospect, is like an 8.6 on the Penn State scale of creepiness. The experiment begins. As the Enterprise goes to warp 1.5, accompanied by the classic tune, Next Generation Theme, Enterprise goes to warp 1.5. Everything is going normally until the assistant turns away from his console to get a good look at Wesley's awesome sweater. And then the engine totally freaks out. The assistant turns his attention back to the console and begins to phase in and out of existence. Up on the bridge, Geordi tells Picard that they're passing warp 10. Then Data tells him the speed is off the scale, so Picard does the safest thing he can think of when you've gone past warp 10 and are now exceeding the scale that Starfleet has established for the warp drive engines, and he orders Data to reverse the engines, something which has never been done before. Just when we think the Enterprise will be torn into 1,000 horrible pieces as everyone is horribly sucked out into the cold vacuum of space, Picard's reckless maneuver works like a charm, and the Enterprise comes to a full stop in the middle of the M33 galaxy, which is 2.7 million light years away from where they started. It will take over 300 years for them to get home, which is a long road trip to take, especially with the jerk store's bestseller Kaczynski along for the ride. Down in engineering, the assistant looks like he's had a little too much Romulan ale, or Will Wheaton homebrew. And Wesley tells him that he can call his mother, who happens to be a doctor, for help. The assistant is saddened that Wesley didn't suggest they play doctor. So he tells him that he just needs to take a rest, and that he means no harm to the Enterprise and all the cute little boys running around on her. Wesley asks if Kaczynski is as big a douchebag as he seems, and the assistant tells him that Kaczynski has sensed some small part of what's going on. Wesley says, "You mean that space, time, and thought aren't the separate things that they appear to be?" Deadheads everywhere put down their bongs and cough out, "Duh. Dick's Picks, Volume 21, man." The assistant totally freaks out, and he tells Wesley that humans aren't ready for such dangerous nonsense. But if he has any extra weed lying around, it would, like, totally help take the edge off of that whole phasing out of reality thing, and he just wants to feel mellow. Can you help him out, Wesley? We haven't gotten to the drugs are bad episode yet. Who knows? Maybe Wesley. You know what? Let's not go down that road. Up on the bridge, Kaczynski pees on everything, and he humps Picard's leg before Picard whacks him on the nose with a newspaper and sends him back to engineering to get them back home. Things get crazy go nuts in a hurry, and the assistant begins to phase out of reality again. The Enterprise heads to Jupiter and beyond the infinite and ends up, according to Data, where none have gone before. To be fair, I think my Data is not as good as my Kaczynski, which I think is more about the attitude and the commitment to being annoyed with the child while being convinced of how awesome you are. Oh, I've just realized something about myself. Anywhere where none have gone before is a cloudy and gaseous-looking place where giant glowing dice fly around. If I had planned ahead, I bet I could put screenshots in this. If I had planned ahead, I would have screenshotted this episode, and then I would have been putting them up throughout all of this. Well, you know what? Live and learn and learn while you live. Anyway, giant glowing dice fly around. I just took my... Wait, here. Ooh, we were no one has gone before. Here, hold on. Yay, everybody! We're going where no one has gone before! Ah! Look at that, I actually got the 20. That was completely by accident. I think I win something. Of course, then I roll a 1 when it actually matters. It's not really a 1, it's a 9. It's okay, I'm disappointed in myself as well. This is how something that should take 15 minutes turns into a thing that takes a half an hour. If you got to leave, it's okay. viewers have dropped by like 15, so I get it. I know. You came to see if it was any good, and then you were like, this is the dumbest thing on the internet since the last dumb thing I saw on the internet, and I've got other things to do. Yeah, everybody's leaving. Okay, thanks. Well, I'm just going to go ahead and finish this for those of you that have decided to stick around. So they're in a cloudy and gaseous-looking place where giant dice fly around. Oh, and it's a billion light-years away from our galaxy where thoughts become reality. You know, like a fish concert. Worf sees a Klingon Targ, Tasha thinks she's running from a rape gang on her home colony, and Picard thinks he's going to step out of a turbo lift and into some kind of giant black void. Turns out it's just a meeting of the Kaczynski is Awesome fan club. Not all the hallucinations are bad, though. One crew member is seen playing a violin with a classic string quartet. Another is dancing a ballet, and Picard stops to have tea with his mother. Of course, the audience's suspension of disbelief is tested when Troy and Dr. Crusher walk together past a number of male crew members and remain entirely clothed. Picard figures out that what they think becomes reality, and he orders everyone to go to general quarters to concentrate on the 1976 Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders having a pillow fight. Back in engineering, everyone tries to accept responsibility for the crisis, Well, everyone except Kaczynski, who wishes he'd saved up some whiz for the occasion. And Riker ultimately tells Picard that it was Wesley. Wesley motherfucking Crusher, bitches, who knew that something was going on, tried to warn them, and nobody listened. That's right! Woo! Go, Wesley! Go, Wesley! It's your birthday! You're Wesley! Sorry. It's pretty clear that the assistant is the only creature on the ship who can get them home. But if that's a reality, why not just think yourselves home, man? Like, really? Come on, you goddamn hippies. Get a job. But Dr. Crusher tells them that the assistant is dying. Well, that kind of sucks. After a commercial, they move to sickbay to try and save the assistant. And this is where the episode, which was really moving along quite nicely, starts to drift a little bit. Right around the time Wesley comes walking into sickbay and whines, "Mom, he's my friend!" Picard wants the boy to shut the fuck up and get back to work, but Riker tells him, "Dude, Captain, come here. The alien totally had a boner for the boy. I bet we could get the boy to shake his ass a little bit," and then the alien, Wesley, says, "Hey, first of all, I can hear you. Second of all, that's a very inappropriate line of dialogue for you to be delivering, sir. Third of all, my name isn't the boy, it's Wesley. Cadet Crusher, if you're nasty." On a personal note, I had a similar conversation with just about every director we ever had on the show. They all insisted on calling me the boy or the kid, and most of them favored grabbing me by the elbow and moving me around the set rather than, you know, giving me direction like I was a person or a professional or anything like that. The worst offender was this guy, Cliff Bull. But for the record, Rob Bowman, who directed this episode, treated me really, really well. We all really liked him. The assistant wakes up and tells Picard that he's a traveler who has super magic powers, and he's been letting Kaczynski take credit for his abilities so he can ride on starships and collect postcards and collector spoons from tourist traps all over the universe. He tells Picard that, quote, "thought is the basis of all reality," and he offers to hook him up with some pants made out of hemp, man. He says that he acts as a lens to focus thoughts. The traveler says that he'll do what he can to get them home, but first, he needs to have a talk with the captain alone. Everyone leaves, and the traveler tells Picard that Wesley is special. He says, "He and a few like him are the reason I travel." Okay, that's creepy. And Picard has the unique ability to encourage Wesley without his mother knowing, of course, to be more like Mozart. What? Eventually, he wraps everything up. "Okay, Captain, Wesley Crusher is like a god, man. He's like a golden god, so don't, like, fuck it up." Man, everything I know about stoners, I learned from watching Cheech and Chong movies. So forgive me, actual stoners, if that's, you know, a hurtful stereotype. The traveler heads back to engineering. Picard goes back to the bridge, and everyone gets ready to go home. Well, they hope. Picard makes an announcement, and he tells everybody that they should, like, chill out, dudes, because, like, everything's going to be totally mellow and stuff. So, like, focus on the traveler and don't harsh his buzz, okay? To help everyone calm down, they turn on the red alert klaxons and lights. When I saw that, when I watched this, you know, in 06 or 07 when I wrote this, I laughed so hard. I peed a little. I'm not afraid to tell you that. I will share with you. I did a little Kaczynski in my pants. The traveler begins doing his thing, and the Enterprise goes to warp speed. The traveler isn't strong enough, but that's all right. Wesley comes over, and he rubs his hand to give him a little boost. And the traveler phases a little bit, throws the football through the swinging tire swing. The Enterprise speeds past Dave Bowman. The traveler phases out of existence entirely, and the Enterprise returns to its own galaxy. I think it's hilarious that I'm making all these stoner jokes, and my viewer count just said that there were 420 viewers. I know what that means, stoners. I'm on to you. Sorry. The Enterprise speeds past Dave Bowman. The traveler phases out of existence entirely, and the Enterprise returns to its own galaxy. Picard tells the ship that they did a good job, and they're all going to get laid. He then calls Wesley up to the bridge and makes him an acting ensign, quote, for outstanding performance in the best Starfleet tradition. Wesley and his shoulder pads take a seat on the bridge, the first acting ensign in the history of Starfleet to wear such an awesome burnt sienna sweater. All right, so that's the synopsis of the show, and let me give you the last little bit, sort of the back matter of the episode. Judging by the comments that I'm seeing sort of flick by here, you're having a good time. I'm glad, because this is a good time for me. Thanks. quotable dialogue. Tasha. What is it? Worf. It's a Klingon Targ. Oh, do I have any Worf things in here? Whole office full of stuff and nothing I can put on my head to look like a Klingon. I bet that's a thing that happens a lot in everyone's daily life. You know how I know my life is weird? I just said, for real, and I meant it, I have an office full of stuff and there's nothing in here I can put on my forehead to help me impersonate a Klingon. What the fuck? Anyway, Worf says, a Klingon Targ. From home. From when I was a child. My Worf sounds a little bit too much like Mr. Sulu. Sorry. A Klingon Targ. A Klingon Targ. There he is. A Klingon Targ. From home. From when I was a child. Tasha. You mean a kitty cat? Yeah, Tasha, that's exactly what he means. Obligatory technobabble. As the power grew, I applied the energy asymptomatically. I anticipated some tilling, but it didn't occur. Now that was my error, using the Bessel functions at the beginning. Kaczynski explaining to Picard how the Enterprise got to the M33 galaxy, and explaining to the writers what type of dialogue they should give Wesley Crusher for the entirety of the second and third seasons. Behind-the-scenes memory. The chief engineer of the week in this episode was Argyle, played by an actor named Biff Yeager. I recall everyone really liking him, and I don't know if it's entirely true. You have to remember that this memory is recalled through a lens that is 25 years thick, and the last 5 to 6 years of that lens are sort of scratched and warped and twisted through the memories of an unreliable teenage narrator. But I remember hearing that Biff was under consideration to become a permanent chief engineer until the producers found out that he or someone acting on his behalf had encouraged Trekkies to write letters asking to have him on the ship full time. There's nothing wrong with a letter writing campaign, but it helps if the letters come in after your episode has aired. Whoops. Some Trekkies complained that they were spammed via direct mail, kids ask your parents. And those two factors sent Chief Engineer Argyle, and sadly, Biff, to the cornfield. Now, when I originally wrote this episode for TV Squad and it was posted online, writer Diane Duane left a comment. It provides a very different perspective on the episode, which I thought was so interesting, I asked for her permission to include in my book, and she gave it to me. So here's what she says. Grin, a happy and irreverent take on a script, which, while it wears Michael's name and mine, has almost nothing of ours left in it but one scene, Michael's scene, of Picard with his mother, and one shot, mine, Picard almost going whoopsie out into open space via the turbolift, an obscure pun on the title of the last novel in a series I've been working on for a while. Michael and I spent almost our entire holiday in England driving our respective spouses crazy as we discussed the pseudonyms we would substitute for our own names on that script. Unfortunately, by the time we got back from the UK, the thing was already in the can, leaving us to spend the rest of our natural lives clutching our heads and moaning about Kaczynski's bad behavior. He wasn't like that when we wrote him. I've got to blog about this in detail someday, but you're not the only one that the rewritten by Morris Hurley dialogue drove insane because of its clunkiness. I didn't really like Morris Hurley very much, and I liked the dialogue he wrote even less. I really wish something like our first draft had made it through. That version, in my opinion, was a ton better, but there was so much politicking and struggling for power going on in the office at the writing end in those days, as you probably know. Sigh. Never mind. The specials are beautiful. Best, Diane. I thought it was really cool that somebody who wrote this episode, like, read my stupid thing that I wrote and then commented on it like that. That's kind of cool. The bottom line. Every episode that preceded this one was a real stinker. So Where No One Has Gone Before is the first time the next generation really starts to come together. This is a solid story, with good pacing and the first truly beautiful visual effects we've seen. Stanley Campbell, who played Kaczynski, turned in a fantastic performance. Kaczynski could have been an entirely one-dimensional character who the audience just hated. But Stanley gave him subtle layers of insecurity that were covered up by his arrogance. In the end, when Kaczynski says to the traveler, "You really need my help? We don't want to laugh at him. And instead, we feel some empathy for the man." This would not have happened if a lesser actor had played the role. However, this show still has its flaws, and the growing pains are evident. Wesley is given horrible dialogue, including the after-school special standby, "Mom, he's my friend." But he's no less annoying than he is in The Naked Now. Not a high bar, admittedly. And Rob Bowman directed me to be as mature as I was capable of being when I was just 14. If you hated Wesley already, it was unlikely that this episode would change your mind. But if you were looking for a glimmer of evidence that he wouldn't be a total weenie for the entire series, well, there's just enough here to get your hopes up before we dash them all to hell in a few episodes. Picard seems to vacillate between extremes in this show, snapping at people and barking orders, then quickly changing his entire tone and attitude to one that's more soothing and warm. I'm not sure if that was a deliberate choice so he would appear as a conflicted man or if it was Patrick Stewart's natural warmth and kindness coming through the gruff demeanor Picard was written to have. Either way, it's confusing and it makes it difficult for the audience to really like and connect with him. Remember, we were still very much in the shadow of the original series at this time, and everyone loved Captain Kirk, so viewers looking for something to dislike in Picard could find it without too much effort. Luckily, Patrick's outstanding abilities as an actor gave Picard strong direction, and the writers would begin tailoring Picard to reflect more of who Patrick was, so he ultimately grew into the character we all love. Final grade, B+. So that, mysterious people on the internet, is my rendition of the chapter where no one has gone before, from my book, Memories of the Future, Volume 1. And I hope that you enjoyed this. This was surprisingly fun for me. I'm going to do a bit of research into ways to make this a bit more interactive, because now it seems like it would be like an appropriate time to answer questions if they existed, but I just don't know how to do that in a timely way that doesn't involve like a really, really long a lag time from the screen. But thanks for watching, and if this is the first time you've ever seen anything like this, you can get information about the book at willwheatonbooks.com, and you can read my blog at willwheaton.net. You can follow me on Tumblr at willwheaton.tumblr.com, and of course right here on Google+. Thanks a lot for listening, everybody. I hope this was fun for you. It was really fun for me. Until next time, this is Will Wheaton saying, don't be a dick. Bye.